Last night, we began the program with President Trump's remarks to reporters in front of first responders in El Paso, Texas. The first words out of his mouth were about the great reception and respect that he got. It wasn't about the dead or the wounded in El Paso or in Dayton. It wasn't about the grieving families or the first responders. It was about him and how loved he was. The last night, after showing that video, I gave the president the benefit of the doubt. Surely, I thought, when the cameras weren't present, he must have properly consoled survivors, praised first responders and hospital staff. Surely he wouldn't have tried to puff himself up in front of those heroes. Well, according to a new piece of video today, I was wrong. There's new video tonight of the president speaking with hospital staffers about the last time he was in El Paso.
I was here 3 months ago. We made a speech and we had what was the name of the arena? That place was packed, right?
I was front row.
Right? The judges have respected
you. I was front row.
What was the name?
I was front row. There.
Oh, good. Come here. That was some crowd.
Thank you.
And we had twice the number outside. And then he had this crazy Beto. Beto had like 400 people in a parking lot. They said his crowd was wonderful.
It's the president of the United States. Let's just make this clear. That's the president of the United States in a hospital that treated many of the people whose bodies were torn apart by a racist gunman who echoed the president's language. Hospital staff are still treating some of the survivors in that hospital. And today we learned that none of the victims actually wanted to see the president. That's according to an official who'd been briefed on the matter. Some didn't want to see anyone. It wasn't about the president particularly. They just didn't want to see anybody, understandably. The rest did not want to see the president specifically. And at the other local hospital treating the wounded, a similar story. Almost every patient said no, so the president did not even visit. Two patients were brought back to the hospital he did visit specifically to see the president, including a two-month-old, Paul Gilbert. His parents were killed in the Walmart. A hospital official familiar with President Trump's visit to the University Medical Center in El Paso told our Jim Acosta that the general assessment was, quote, that there was a, quote, absence of empathy by the president, unquote, on the president's part. This official, Jim Acosta, that Jim spoke with, mentioned that the clip you just saw and said it left the impression that the president was not as focused on consoling patients as might be expected, which is strange because generally that is all that's expected of a president visiting a hospital in a city where 22 people have just been murdered. Nothing more. Just that. Just empathy, listening, consoling. Just being in the moment as a normal, caring human being would, as anybody would. Or barring that, simply pretending to be that. A normal, caring human being. The president, after all, spent years playing a character on TV. He played a successful business executive and, as he'd quickly point out, got good ratings for a while. He could have looked at this as a performance on the biggest stage yet, and as obscene as that sounds, that act of pretending, that simulation of human kindness and caring, it might at least have brought solace to a few people. But even pretending to care was too much, perhaps because it wouldn't have meant not boasting about his reception earlier in Dayton, Ohio, or making up stories about his host to justify the grievance he was venting, which he did about the mayor of Dayton and Senator Sherrod Brown of Ohio.
I took him in at their request. We made the tour. They couldn't believe it. She said it to people. He said it to people. I get on Air Force One, where they do have a lot of televisions. I turn on the television, and there they are saying, well, I don't know if it was appropriate for the president to be here, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You know, the same old line. And they're very dishonest people, and that's probably why he got, I think, about 0% that he failed as a presidential candidate.
Again, that's on, in front of first responders there. And he's talking about on a flight from a city where 9 people died, where he had just been, to a city he was going to, with 22 fatalities, and that's what he's watching television, and he's concerned about it, and he's angry that Sherrod Brown is saying stuff. And what he was saying wasn't even, he actually complimented the president. The president also rage tweeted about his treatment and had his social media director and former caddy, I should point out, tweet about what a, quote, rock star he was in Dayton. At one point, according to the New York Times, he shouted that no one was defending him. Because on a trip to a pair of grieving cities that saw a combined 31 people slaughtered, let's never forget who the real victim is. Today we learned that multiple staffers say this was not a successful trip. And again, these are not supposed to be that difficult, at least not in the sense of being difficult to conduct oneself properly on. They are, in fact, tremendously difficult in the sense of being painful to bear and bear witness to. They're supposed to be. These are, for a president, evidence that the country they are responsible for has been wounded, sometimes very deeply, and they feel it deeply, often personally. They're supposed to, and it's supposed to show. Just as it shows when a tweet like this pops up on the president's timeline from Air Force One, sent minutes after departure from the scene of such heartache. Quoting from the tweet, "Leaving El Paso for the White House, what great people I met there, and in Dayton, Ohio. The fake news worked overtime trying to disparage me and the two trips, but it just didn't work. The love, respect, and enthusiasm were there for all to see. They've been through so much. Sad." Enthusiasm for the president. As we said earlier and many times before, this is just not normal. And it's starting to seem normal, but it's not. And it's not how a president should behave. It's just not. It's not how people behave, and it's got nothing to do with politics, but everything to do with what presidents in both parties have always known, that at times of national tragedy, the presidency should never be about the person in the White House. It should be about what that person can do for the people he serves. I want you to just, you know, we all think this is now how presidents talk and how this is presidential speech. It's not. I want to show you three presidents, Clinton, Reagan, and George W. Bush, in moments of crisis for this country. Clinton after the Oklahoma City bombings, Reagan after the Challenger disaster, W. Bush at a mosque just days after 9/11, at a mosque, remember. Three presidents who could not be more different one from another, and the grace that each of them showed.
Our words seem small beside the loss you have endured.
The families of the seven, we cannot bear as you do the full impact of this tragedy, but we feel the loss. And we're thinking about you so very much.
In our anger and emotion, our fellow Americans must treat each other with respect.
Let us let our own children know that we will stand against the forces of fear. When there is talk of hatred, let us stand up and talk against it. When there is talk of violence, let us stand up and talk against it.
Your loved ones were daring and brave, and they had that special grace. That special spirit that says, give me a challenge, and I'll meet it with joy.
You know, this is a great country. It's a great country because we share the same values of respect and dignity and human worth.
In the face of death, let us honor life. As St. Paul admonished us, let us not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good.
The face of terror is not the true faith of Islam.
If anybody thinks Americans have lost the capacity for love and caring and courage, they ought to come to Oklahoma.
The crew of the Space Shuttle Challenger honored us for the manner in which they lived their lives. We will never forget them, nor the last time we saw them this morning as they prepared for their journey and waved goodbye and slipped the surly bonds of Earth to touch the face of God.
Seems like a long time ago, that kind of language.